We will study chapter 2 from the letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. As we know from chapter 4 verse 2 that there was a conflict between two women in the church of Philippi. That's why St. Paul in his letter emphasized the importance of preserving the unity, how to have one mind, one thought, one accord, one spirit. Conflicts usually happens because of our ego. Everyone wants to pursue his agenda. Everyone, he wants his opinion to be the final opinion. That's why in order to avoid conflict, we need to be humble. Humbleness is an essential element in unity and to have same mind. Even if we look at our families, when there is conflict between family members, the conflict mainly is because of lack of humbleness. It's because of pride and ego. And St. Paul in chapter 2 give us the perfect example of humbleness, which is our Lord Jesus Christ. How he emptied himself and how he became very, very humble when he took the form of man and obeyed unto the cross. And St. Paul asking us to follow the example of our Lord Jesus Christ. And if you want to know whether you are a humble person or not, examine your obedience. If you are obedient, then you are a humble person, because obedience is the fruit of humbleness. The prideful person, it is very difficult for him to obey and to submit. Then, after St. Paul emphasizes the importance of unity, he said, when we become one, actually our light will be shining before others. If you hear about any group that's divided and there is conflict among them, you cannot learn anything from them. Actually, you will be offended. And let me tell you, in many, many churches, I hear people and youth are leaving the church because of the conflict, because of division. But when there is unity, when there is oneness in mind and spirit, actually the church will reflect the light of Christ. So the light will be shining before others. And this will bring joy to the heart of a shepherd. Like any parent, when he sees his children are divided, fighting, there is conflict among them, he will be grieved. But any parent, when he sees how his children loving each other, actually in unity together and in harmony together, this will bring joy. In the same way, when the shepherd sees his children walking in unity, this actually will bring joy to his heart and also will prove to him that his service, his ministry, his labor was not in vain. Was not in vain. And actually, at the end of this chapter, chapter 2, St. Paul explained or shared with them his plans regarding two disciples, Timothy and Epaphroditus. So let's start reading verse by verse from Philippians chapter 2. Verse 1. Therefore means he is making a conclusion based on what is said. So if we go to chapter 1, the last verse in chapter 1, he is saying in verse 27, he is saying that you stand fast in one spirit with one mind. Verse 27 from chapter 1, that you stand fast in one spirit with one mind. So St. Paul actually wants them to stand fast in one spirit and in one mind. In chapter 2, he is saying, therefore, if there is any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any affection and mercy, fulfill my joy by being like-minded. So St. Paul is telling them, therefore, I want you to be one-minded, one spirit, one accord. And in order to keep the one mind and the one spirit and the one accord, he told them, there are four motives for you. The first motive is the consolation that we received from Christ. When we know his love for us, his sacrifice for us, this will bring comfort to my soul. His promises, do not fear, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Such promises gives comfort and joy and consolation to the heart. Also, the love of God toward us and the love of the community toward each other, this will bring also comfort and consolation in the heart. I'm sure when you are in conflict with somebody, you don't feel peace in your heart. But when you see how the whole community loves each other and serving together and living together in harmony and in love, this will bring comfort and joy to our heart. The third element is the fellowship flowing from the Spirit. Again, our fellowship with one another. Fellowship means what? I need you and you need me. I depend on you and you depend on me. I cannot live by myself alone. That's why God created us as assembled people and made us assembled people in his body. This fellowship will bring also comfort and joy to the heart. People who are living in isolation, they complain of loneliness. But in the body of Christ, we don't complain of loneliness because everybody is comforted through the fellowship. And also the affection and the mercy. The affection that we are experiencing from one another and the mercy toward the weak. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. The mercy that we are experiencing in our life from God toward us and toward each other. All these elements help us to be one in mind and one in spirit. So St. Paul is telling them, now you are members in the body of Christ. See the blessings that you have. You have consolation from Christ. You have comfort from the love of God and the love of one another. You have fellowship of the Spirit. You have affection and you have mercy. Because of this, all elements, then fulfill my joy by being like-minded. Fulfill my joy by being my like-minded. As I told you, the joy of the shepherd when he sees his children one-minded, one spirit, and one accord. Fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Having the same love toward everybody, without favoritism, without partiality, having the same love for everybody. One accord and one mind. And by the way, this doesn't cancel the diversity. In the body of Christ, there is unity in diversity. We are different organs, different members in the body of Christ. Each member is a very unique member. But in spite of these differences, all of them work together in harmony and live together in love. So he said, it is unity in mind, that's our goal, to be like-minded. The goal to have unity in mind. And unity in accord, we are living together in harmony. And unity in love, if there is love, it's the energy behind the oneness. The energy behind oneness. What will make us be one together? It is the love in our heart. If there is no love in our heart, it will be difficult to live in unity and in harmony. In verse 3, he told us about some things that we need to avoid. Some points or some vices that we need to avoid in order to preserve the unity. He said, let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit, but in lowliness of mind. Let each esteem others better than himself. So he told us, we need actually to avoid selfish ambition. He's telling them, some of you, like these two women that had a conflict among each other, he told them, why do you have a conflict? Because you have parting spirit, a spirit that divides the people. Instead of having the same mind and the same goal, you're having a divided spirit. So let nothing be done through selfish ambition. Selfish ambition, I put my interest before others. It is my interest first, should come first. Or conceit. Conceit is like pride. I see myself better than others. But in lowliness of mind, as I told you in the introduction, it takes humbleness in order to live in unity. And when actually we become humble, we will not put our interest as first, but actually we will put the interest of others before our interest. We will not look for our interest, but will put interest of others before our interest. As he said, let each esteem others better than himself. In our families, if everyone puts the interest of others before himself or herself, and esteem the others better than themselves, we will live in unity, in harmony, and in love. Verse 4. Let each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interests of others. Again, he is emphasizing the same meaning. Actually, when we adopt the lowliness of mind, humbleness, when we esteem others better than ourselves, when we look to the interest of others, that's how we will live in unity and harmony. Three things we need to actually keep in our mind. Humbleness, esteem others better than ourselves, and put the interest of others before our interest. If we kept these three things, we'll be able to live in humbleness and in unity with each other. Verse 5. Now he is giving them the example, the perfect example in humbleness and in humility. He said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Jesus Christ. He told them, you need to acquire the mind of Christ. The mind of Christ, which is the humble mind of Christ. Although he is God, but he humbled himself, as we read in verse 6. Who being in the form of God, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God. So he is saying, when the Lord Jesus Christ declared himself as God, this was not an act of robbery, because he is God. He did not steal something that's not his. So it is not robbery, it's not an act of robbery. But sometimes when we put ourselves better than others, actually we are stealing something that's not ours. When we take the glory of God to be our own glory, actually we are stealing something that's not others. So he's telling them, God, actually, if he acted on earth as better than all the people, this will not be robbery, because he is God, he is our creator. But he didn't do this. So how we put ourselves before others, how we put ourselves above others, how we esteem ourselves better than others, if we do this, actually this is an act of robbery. But God, Jesus Christ, who is God, did not act as better than us or above us. But actually, he born as a poor person. He lived as a very, very humble person. And as he said, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. Verse 7, but made himself of no reputation. Although he is glorified by the angels and archangels, by the cherubim and seraphim, but when he is born, he made himself of no reputation. He was born among animals in a manger, taking the form of a bond servant. He took our form, which we were created from the dust of the earth. But it's out of him humbleness, out of his humbleness, he took our form. And coming in the likeness of men. This is actually a great humbleness. Made himself of no reputation, had another translation, which is emptied himself. Emptied himself. What does it mean, emptied himself? This means he took our perfect humanity and he did not let his divinity to interfere with his humanity. Although his divinity and humanity never separated from each other. As we say in the confession, that he made his humanity one with his divinity, without confusion, without mingling, or without alteration. And his divinity parted not from his humanity, even for a single moment or a twinkling of an eye. But in spite of this unity, he grew little by little. He did not let his divinity make him as a child, for example, to be all-knowing. But as we read in Luke chapter 2, he was growing. He was growing in wisdom, in grace, before God and before men. He's growing in stature, grace, and wisdom. That is the meaning of emptied himself. And taking the form of a bond servant, he gave up his will completely to do the will of God, to do the will of his Father, God the Father. As he said, let it be according to your will, not according to my will. This doesn't mean that there is a conflict between the will of the Father and the will of the Son. But this means actually total submission of the will of the Son to the will of the Father. That's the meaning of bond servant. Verse 8, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even the death of the cross. Actually, the humbleness of our Lord Jesus Christ was manifested in his obedience. I told you, the fruit of humbleness is obedience. And the Lord Jesus Christ obeyed. To what extent? Sometimes we obey, but when it reaches a certain limit, we say, enough is enough. I cannot submit anymore. I cannot obey anymore. But the Lord Jesus Christ obeyed even unto the death of the cross. Actually, this reminds me with what St. Paul written in the book of Hebrews, his letter to Hebrews, chapter 10, and starting from verse 5. This will explain to us what he meant, but he obeyed unto death, the death of the cross. If you turn your Bible to Hebrews chapter 10, verse 5, we read, therefore, when he, Jesus, came into the world, he said to the Father, Jesus now is speaking to the Father, sacrifice and offering you did not desire. You know, Jesus was born as a high priest, and as a high priest has to offer something. But he said to the Father, I know you don't desire me as a priest to offer animal sacrifices, but a body you have prepared for me. You give me a body to offer it as a sacrifice. In burnt offering and sacrifices for sin, you had no pleasure. Jesus is saying to the Father, you had no pleasure in burnt animal offering and sacrifices, but you want me to offer myself, to offer my body. So what would Jesus do? Would he say yes or no? God said to the Lord Jesus Christ, I want you to offer yourself as a sacrifice. So you will be the high priest and you will be the sacrifice in the same time. You will offer yourself. Verse 7, then I said, Jesus now is saying to the Father, behold, I have come, as it is written in the volume of the book, as it's written of me, to do your will, O God. So he said, if this is your will for me to offer myself, I will do it. I will offer myself. I will not offer animal sacrifices, but I will come to offer myself as a sacrifice. That's the obedience. That's what St. Paul said. He obeyed unto death, even the death of the cross. Even if this obedience means he will offer himself as a sacrifice, he will offer his body as a sacrifice, he will do it. The fruit of humbleness, the fruit of obedience. Verse 9. Therefore, God also has highly exalted him and given him the name which is above every name. Because of his humbleness, God the Father exalted him. So I can say humbleness is the road to exaltation. Humbleness is the road to glorification. So because of his humbleness and obedience, God exalted him. You may say, but he's already exalted. He's already God. Yes. But now I'm speaking about God who became man and took the form of man, the Lord Jesus Christ. The incarnate Son of God ascended to heaven and seated at the right hand of the Father, and now is exalted above all power, above all principality. And the name of Jesus, actually this name is given to the incarnate Son of God. So before the birth of Christ, the name of Jesus actually was known. It is the same like Joshua. But this name has no power as after the birth of Christ. After the birth of Christ, the name of Jesus actually is exalted above every name. This name actually scares out the demons. In the name of Jesus, demons are cast away. In the name of Jesus, people are saved. In the name of Jesus, we can conquer our enemies, Satan and all his powers. So, because of his obedience, God the Father exalted the Lord Jesus Christ, seated him at his right hand. He made him the judge of the whole world, and his name, this name now, Jesus means Savior, is a very, very powerful name. In all our psalms, for the whole week, actually we speak about the name of Jesus. How when we say the name of Jesus, it brings joy and heart, joy and comfort in our heart. How the name of Jesus is sweet in the mouth of the saints. That's the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only that, verse 10, that at the name of Jesus, when we hear the name of Jesus, every knee should bow, not only on earth, but of those in heaven, and of those on earth, and of those under the earth. That's why when we mention the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, actually we bow at the mention of his name, because that's the name of the salvation. It's name of God who humbled himself and made himself of no reputation in order to save us. All the creation bow to him in love and in submission. The angels, the humans, or even the demons, they bow to him, but in fear and trembling. In the name of Jesus, as I told you, demons are cast away. Verse 11, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Now actually, every tongue, from every nation, from every tribe. See, Christians are in all nations. So every tongue on earth, every tongue on earth, and even tongues in heaven, every tongue confess his divinity and confess that Jesus is God, the Savior of the whole world. And by doing this, they are glorifying God the Father who sent him for the salvation of the world. So in this part, from verse 1 to verse 11, St. Paul emphasizes the importance of unity, importance of having same mind. And he told us about some motivations, like the fellowship of love, the consolation of Christ, the comfort of the Spirit. All this motivate us to have one mind. And he told us some things we need to avoid, like selfish ambition, like conceit, like parting spirit. We need to avoid all of this. And to have the Lord Jesus Christ in his humbleness as our role model, as our example. To have the mind of Christ. And what is the mind of Christ? He humbled himself and he obeyed. Obeyed to what extent? Even unto death, the death of the cross. And the fruit of this obedience, that God exalted him, exalted the Lord Jesus Christ, exalted the name of Jesus. And now, by the name of Jesus, many people would be saved. Every knee bows when they hear the name of Jesus, and also they confess that Jesus is God. Verse 12, based on what he explained, he said, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Therefore, because of God's love toward us, because of his obedience, because of his sacrifice, because you need to have the same mind, and as you obey, I encourage you and I urge you to obey. But some people actually obey only in the presence of the parents, the teacher, the servant, the priest. But St. Paul is telling them the true obedience when you obey in my absence, not in my presence. Because if you obey only in my presence, this is hypocrisy. You are obeying because I am here, but in my absence, you will do something else. So don't show obedience only in my presence, but you need actually to show obedience in my absence. This is the true obedience, to obey in my absence. And by obeying, even in my absence, actually you are working out your own salvation. And let me just use this verse. Work out your own salvation means there is work I need to do in order to be saved. How come? We know that salvation is by the grace of God. So what do I want to do in order to be saved? Is the grace of God not enough? St. Paul is saying, actually, the grace of God gives us salvation as a gift. But we need to work in order to receive His gift. Our will and our effort is nothing without His grace. But His grace, the grace of God, is inactive without our will and without our works. Again, our will and our work is nothing without the grace of God. But His grace, also the grace of God, is inactive without our will and without our work. That's why He told them, work out your own salvation in fear and trembling. How to work out your salvation? By sincere obedience. When you obey God, when you obey the commandment of God, when you obey God with fear and trembling. Fear means reverence. And what's trembling here? Is it trembling from God? Of course not. Because we don't tremble from God. We fear Him, we revere Him. But trembling here from the consequences of disobedience. Those who are disobedient, they will not be saved. And they will suffer eternally in the lake of fire. So when we remember the punishment of the perishing people, this brings trembling to our heart. So St. Paul is saying, if you are not willing to obey out of fear of God, out of reverence of God, think about the punishment of the sinners. Think about the punishment of the perishing. And this actually will bring a trembling to your heart and will help you to obey. So you need to obey with your utmost care, with diligence, with this anxiety that you will not be saved. You should be anxious lest you be saved. You should be anxious and concerned about your eternal salvation. Verse 13. For it is God who works in you both to will and to do for His good pleasure. So here actually this verse, he combines the grace of God with our work. He said it is God, it is the grace of God who works in you. It is the grace of God who works in you to do two things. Number one, to will, to desire. And number two, to fulfill this will, to do, to will and to do. And the ultimate goal, for His good pleasure. So we need to open our hearts for the grace of God. How we open our hearts to the grace of God? You know, the grace of God works in a certain atmosphere. When we pray, when we read the Bible, when we attend the church, when we take communion, actually we are entering the sphere of the grace of God. We are entering into the field of the grace of God. That's why all these spiritual exercises, we call it the means of grace. When I pray, when I read the Bible, when I come to the church, I am entering into the sphere of grace. So when I enter into the sphere of grace, the grace actually will motivate my will. I will have the desire. I want to be like God. I want to be holy like my Heavenly Father. I want to be perfect like my Heavenly Father. So the grace of God will move the will and the desire inside me. then it's not enough to have the will. How to do it? And again, the grace of God will empower me to do the commandment of God. So the commandment will not be difficult or impossible for me, but I can see it possible through the grace of God. As St. Paul said, I can do all things in Jesus Christ who strengthens me. So here we can see the three elements: the grace of God, the will of the person, and the work of the person. Your will and your work needs the grace of God, because the grace of God is inactive in you if you don't have the will or you don't do your work. For his good pleasure means what? Means in order to carry out his sovereign gracious purpose toward us, which is our salvation. So actually, when our will and our work will work with the grace of God, we will bring actually pleasure to the heart of God, and we will fulfill his good pleasure toward us, which is our salvation. Verse 14. Do all things without complaining and disputing. Again, in humbleness and obedience, people will not argue. People will not challenge everything. Humble people actually submit easily. Some of us actually, they challenge and they dispute everything, every rule. When the church puts an order, they try to challenge it and try to dispute it. When in the family the parents puts rule or instruction, the children try to challenge it and to push it to the limit. St. Paul said, this is not a spirit of humbleness. And if they did not get their way, they start to complain. That's why St. Paul said, do all things without complaining and disputing. Actually, if we learned how to be humble and how to be obedient, we will not complain or dispute. Complaining and disputing are the fruit of wanting to carry my own will, pride and ego. I want my will to be done. That's why it is actually glorifying one's ego, glorifying my own pride, glorifying my own ego. And complaining and disputing are destructive to the unity and the oneness in Christ. When we complain, when we argue, when we challenge, actually we'll be divided. And I want just to say a warning here about complaining and negatively speaking in front of our children. Sometimes when we sit with our children, we complain and we negatively speak about the church. And when actually we complain and speaking negative about the church, this will be registered in their mind and their heart. When they will grow, they will stop coming to the church. And here parents will be surprised. Why my children refuse to come to the church? We used to bring them with us every Sunday to the church. That's true. Because nobody is perfect. And no church is perfect. If you want to find something negative, you will find it. That's why St. Paul said, please don't complain. Please don't dispute. This is destructive to the unity. So when I see something wrong, should I be silent? No. I can discuss it, but in a constructive way. And I can discuss it with the people or the person who's in charge. But speaking about it with my children and gossiping about it, you know, it will not help. But if I discussed with the person in charge, this might help to improve the service. Again, St. Paul told us, if you are humble, then stop complaining and stop disputing. Verse 15. Then what will happen? If you are humble and you are obedient and keeping the unity of faith and the unity of spirit, what will happen? That you may become blameless, harmless, children of God, without fault, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation, among whom you shine as light in the world. So he told us there will be five things here, five blessings when you are humble and obedient. What are the five blessings? Number one, you will be blameless. Blameless before God. When you stand before God, God will find you without blemish. Also, you will be harmless. Harmless toward others. You are not going to harm anybody or to offend anybody. Number three, you will be a peacemaker. Remember in the Beatitude, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God. Children of God are peacemakers. You will keep the unity of the church through making peace. Without fault, not offending anybody, not offending anybody. So before God, I'm without blame. Before people, with no fault. And before people, I'm harmless. I don't harm anybody. And not only that, but also I'm a peacemaker. What about among those outside the church? So these four qualities among God, or before God and before the believers. Before God, without blame. Before the believers, harmless. I don't harm anybody. Without fault, I don't offend anybody. Children of God, I'm a peacemaker. What about outside, the non-believer? St. Paul said, the non-believers are like darkness, and you will be like light shining in this darkness, as the Lord told us, you are the light of the world. So he said, in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. Why St. Paul called them crooked and perverse generation? Because they rejected the Son of God. They rejected Christ. They did not believe in him. That's why they are crooked and perverse generation. But among them, you shine as light in the world. Shining as light in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation that wants to glorify itself. That is the mind of the world, seeking self-glory. Verse 16, holding fast the word of life, so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain or labored in vain. He's telling them, this obedience, to whom? Maybe somebody will ask, whom should I obey? We are speaking about obedience, obedience, obedience. Whom should I obey? So St. Paul is clarifying, obedience here is to the commandment of God. That's why he said, holding fast the word of life. In order to acquire the mind of Christ and live in unity and humbleness, we need to hold fast the word of life, the Bible, the scripture, to obey the commandment of God. In the last day, every shepherd actually will see whether his labor, his service, his ministry was in vain or not in vain. When the shepherd sees that his children are saved and crowned with crowns of glory and standing before God in the last day without blemish, this actually will be like a crown on the head of the shepherd. It brings joy that all his service, all his ministry was not in vain. That's why St. Paul said, if you obey the word of life, I may rejoice in the day of Christ. Which day? That is the second coming of Christ, day of judgment. That I have not run in vain or labored in vain. That all my ministry, all my service was not in vain, but actually my service and ministry was fruitful, because all of you before Christ are without blemish and without fault. So St. Paul is telling them, I want you to obey God so I can rejoice in you in the second coming of Christ. Verse 17. Yes, and if I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all. So St. Paul here is saying, when they used to offer a sacrifice, they used to pour on this sacrifice some offering, whether it is blood or oil, they pour on the sacrifice. So St. Paul is saying, even if myself I am poured out like a drink offering, my blood will be shed like a drink offering, I'm not disappointed, I'm not upset. Actually, I am happy. I'm happy that I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith. So, when you obey, it is a sacrifice. Obedience is a sacrifice. You are sacrificing your will. You are sacrificing your ego. So, St. Paul is saying, when you obey, you are offering a sacrifice. And my service and my running from continent to continent is like I am pouring myself as a drink offering on your sacrifice. And this actually brings happiness to me. When I die, when I shed my blood, I am glad and rejoice with you all. It is actually a very, very nice metaphor here. When St. Paul said, my labor, my service is like a drink offering. But the main offering is your obedience, is your sacrifice, is your faith, humbleness and unity. And this will bring joy to you, and this will bring joy to me. And here we can see joy in the midst of suffering. Joy in the midst of suffering. Pouring himself as a drink offering, that's shedding his blood. Literally shedding his blood. But he's saying, I am glad and rejoice. Rejoice and glad, why? Because of their salvation. So here we can see joy in the midst of suffering. Verse 18, for the same reason, you also be glad and rejoice with me. It's not me who will be happy only, but also you will be happy. You will be happy because you will be exalted. You will be happy because you will be glorified. You will be happy because you will be saved. You will be happy because you will have a portion with all the saints in the kingdom of heaven. So here we can see the mutual joy. He is joyful when they are obedient, and they are joyful when they see his sacrifice and his ministry as a drink offering. Then actually from verse 19 to the end of the chapter, he is addressing some administrative issues about Timothy and Epaphroditus. Verse 19, he said, but I trust in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you shortly, that I also may be encouraged when I know your state. St. Paul wrote this letter while he was in prison. St. Paul wrote this letter while he was in prison. That's why he cannot visit them. So he told them, I know I cannot visit you because I'm in prison. But I will send Timothy. Why he will send Timothy? In his humbleness, he didn't tell them, I will send Timothy to support you or to encourage you. But he said, no, I'm sending Timothy. So when he reports to me your state and your condition, this will encourage me in my prison. Actually, St. Paul here, although he is supporting them, but in his humbleness, he is saying, I will be encouraged when I know your condition. verse 20, for I have no one like-minded who will sincerely care for your state. St. Paul is saying, when I send Timothy, don't despise him, don't say he is young or a disciple. Actually, I trust himself as much as I trust Timothy as much as I trust myself. He has the same mind like me, like-minded like me. He is the same mind like me. He sincerely cares for you. He loves you and he cares for each one of you, not like others. He doesn't seek his own interest, but their own interest, like St. Paul. Verse 21, for all other teachers seek their own interest, not the things which are of Jesus Christ. Timothy is different. When I send Timothy, he will come to you not seeking his own interest, but he will be seeking your interest, which is the interest of Christ. Because what is the interest of Christ? He doesn't desire the death of a sinner, but rather that he returns and lives. And Timothy also desire your salvation, which is the interest of Christ. Verse 22, but you know his proven character, that as a son with his father, he served with me in the gospel. He said, I'm not saying this just a compliment, but I tested him, and his character was proven during the time of hardship. In the time of my imprisonment, when I'm in prison, he served me as obedient son with his father. So I'm not just saying words of compliment, but I'm testifying, because he was tested and his character was proven during the time of hardship. Verse 23, therefore I hope to send him at once, as soon as I see how it goes with me. So he's telling them, I will see my situation, what will happen to me, and in the first opportunity, I will send him to you. But I trust in the Lord that I myself shall also come shortly. So St. Paul is saying, I know that the Lord will release me from this prison, and I will come and visit you by myself too. So now I'm sending Timothy, but through your prayers and through your support, I know that I will be released from the prison and visit you. Then he's speaking about another servant, Epaphroditus, in verse 25. Yet I consider it necessary to send to you Epaphroditus, my brother, fellow worker, and fellow soldier, but your messenger, and the one who ministered to my need. Nice description of Epaphroditus here. He described him as his brother, fellow worker, so he is serving with him in the field of Christ. Fellow soldier, you know, St. Paul used to describe the servant as soldiers. Why soldiers? Because they are taking their ministry and their service very seriously, like a soldier. Number two, because they are in spiritual warfare. They are fighting against Satan and all his powers. But for you, he's your messenger, he's your servant. He's delivering the message of Christ to you, their messenger. Because through him, and also he describes him as their messenger, because they sent some offering and donation to St. Paul by Epaphroditus. So he told them, he is also your messenger because you sent me some donation through Epaphroditus. And the last description, that he ministered, he served St. Paul during his need, during the time of his imprisonment. Very nice description of Epaphroditus. Verse 26, he's explaining why he is sending Epaphroditus. Epaphroditus was sick, and God healed him. When he was sick, actually, St. Paul was very disturbed. So the healing of Epaphroditus brought joy to the heart of St. Paul. And St. Paul considered that God had mercy on him by the healing of Epaphroditus. Also, Epaphroditus, who was from Philippi, knew that the church in Philippi heard about his illness. So he was disturbed because he wanted them not to worry about him. So when he sent Epaphroditus and they see him, how he is healed and how he is in good health and good condition, they will be comforted. That's what he said in verse 26. Since he was longing for you all and was distressed because you had heard that he was sick. He's saying he wants to come and see you. He was distressed when you heard that he is sick and you are worried about him. So St. Paul actually considered that the healing of St. Paul, the healing of Epaphroditus, was an act of mercy toward St. Paul, as we read in verse 27. For indeed, he was sick almost unto death. It was a serious illness. But God had mercy on him. He healed Epaphroditus. And not only on him, but on me also. Lest I should have sorrow upon sorrow. If something happened to him, I would be very sorrowful. So when God actually healed him, God did not only have mercy on Epaphroditus, but also had mercy on me, Paul. Otherwise, I would have sorrow upon sorrow. Verse 28, therefore, I sent him the more eagerly. I sent him quickly to you, that when you see him again, you may rejoice. You may rejoice that he is well, and I may be less sorrowful. I will not be distressed that you are worried about him. I will not be disturbed that you are worried about Epaphroditus. So we can say the reason why St. Paul sent Epaphroditus quickly, because Epaphroditus was longing to the church in Philippi. He was distressed when they heard that he was sick, and in order to bring joy to their hearts when they see his well-being, and St. Paul become less sorrowful. Verse 29, receive him therefore in the Lord with all gladness, and hold such men in esteem. So you need to receive him as befit the servants of Christ, and hold such men, hold Epaphroditus and Timothy in esteem, in honor, as the servant of Christ. They should receive him with gladness, honor, as the servant of Christ. Verse 30, because for the work of Christ, now he is explaining why he became sick. He became sick actually because of his ministry, because of his travel, because of the effort that he spent in ministry. Because for the work of Christ, he came close to death, not regarding his life, to supply what was lacking in your service toward me. So he's saying, why he came close to death? For the work of Christ. Not regarding his own life, not caring about his own health. He cared only to fulfill the calling of Christ. He did not pay attention to his own health. And also, he supplied what was lacking in the service of the Philippians towards St. Paul. For example, if a servant saw another servant not doing his ministry well, instead of complaining or instead of gossiping about the servant, he will actually go and supply what was lacking. That's what Epaphroditus did. When Epaphroditus said, so that the Philippians did not minister to the need of St. Paul properly, so he supplied what was lacking on their part in their service toward St. Paul. That's why he told them, you need to hold such men like Epaphroditus and also Timothy and all the servants of Christ, hold them in honor and in esteem as the servant of Christ. This actually concludes chapter 2, in which St. Paul spoke about the importance of the unity, and he spoke about two servants, Timothy and Epaphroditus, and there are many lessons that we can learn from their ministry. Glory be to God forever and ever. Do you have any comments or questions about chapter 2?